Hi, I'm Amy Eisenstein. I'm here today with Kimberly Blease, the EVP of Blakely, who's going to talk about mid-value donors. Welcome, Kimberly.
Thank you, Amy. Thank you.
So let's talk about first defining mid-value donors. What do we mean by that, and why are they important?
Well, mid-value donors typically are defined for organizations based on the size of program that they have and the type of giving that they have. So for one organization, a mid-value donor might be $500 to $5,000. For another organization, it might be $1,000 to $25,000. So if they've got a really robust mid-value program and major gift program, typically it tends to skew higher. But for most of the organizations that we work with, I would say it's safe to say 500 to 25,000, and that's sort of the range we're talking about. Not quite in major gift, but definitely not in the on the average side either.
Yeah.
The importance of it, I mean, it's got to be my favorite topic, talking about high-value donors, mid-value donors, because I think they're a really undervalued area of focus for us as fundraisers. Many times they're kind of managed off the side of an annual file. Everybody knows how important they are, everybody loves them, but nobody really does anything differently to engage them. So in our experience, one of the best ways to double and triple revenue from mid-value giving is to really pay attention to what they need. We've been working with Blue Frog, Mark Phillips out of the UK, for a number of years. He's got about 20 years of research behind him in mid-value and legacy donors. We look at donor needs, so it's a bit of a different sort of look at what donors need from our organizations in order to do more. And often, one of the biggest things we found with mid-value donors is that much of our communications that we send to people just don't feel like it's for them. So they look at things and they say, that's not really for me, mm-hmm. Because they're giving at such a bigger average than the regular donor is. So a lot of the communications are irrelevant, and that's determined by the donor, actually. But we just keep sending things. So one of the things that we always say is kind of, it is the definition of insanity. We keep doing the same things, but we want our donors to increase their giving.
Yeah.
And until we're prepared to do something different, I don't think that's ever going to happen.
Yeah. So what should organizations do?
That's a good question. So we've been working with a number of organizations around the world in really building a very different approach to mid-value giving. We actually take a hard look at linking a lot of the strategies with legacy giving over time, and we create quite an interesting and robust program for individuals within programs. It's really about delivering what people need from the organization to do more. Part of it is taking them on the journey. So part of it is creating donor journeys that actually make sense, that actually inspire them along the way. And I think we often in the annual side work very hard at coming up with new things to put in front of our donors. And actually what donors really want, and the research has said this in every single country we've done it in, is they not just want to be treated as special, not told they're special, treated as special,
yeah.
But they want to be taken on the journey with the organization. They understand if you're an organization fighting cancer or that you have big lofty goals around poverty, things don't happen in a day. There's steps along the way. And donors, particularly our best donors, are often willing to go on that journey with us as long as we take them there as we go.
Yeah.
And it's difficult because I think as organizations, you know, sometimes that big goal, that cure or that end goal seems so far away for many.
Yeah.
And mid-value donors in particular really want to understand what are the steps to get there.
Yeah, so tell us what it looks like to take a donor on a journey.
Yeah. So first of all, big part of it is the whole integration piece of all the channels and all of the sort of ways you communicate. And we create donor journeys so that we really have a hard look at what are people going to see and hear and feel from you as an organization as they're going. And sometimes it's hard to put ourselves in the donor's shoes. I think that we have to realize that as organizations, we have to do the heavy lifting. We have to prioritize. We have to sort out what the schedule is going to look like. So we create often sort of in 2-year bands a journey that has all of the different channels at our disposal, all of the different elements at our disposal. If we have dedicated people, then that kind of plays into that. If we don't, then how do we manage sort of that human touch side? And then we create content and fundraising propositions that actually meet people's needs. And so when I say that, what I really mean is that we often aren't putting the same kinds of asks that regular donors are getting in front of these people. One of the wonderful things, though, about doing that in our experience, in our testing, is that you can often build programs out that have feedback campaigns and thank you stewardship campaigns, all related to the core topic that you set up, so the core proposition. So it's great because people actually engage more with that kind of treatment than
right.
they do with
So
regular.
How is that different from mm-hmm. the regular annual fund population,
yeah.
right?
Yeah. Well, often in annual giving, we tend, if we're mailing, say, 6 or 8, or we're, there's even people mailing 10 or 11 or 12 times a year, we are often looking for new subjects. So, you know, here's a special, here's a renewal, here's a year end, here's a holiday. And with our mid-level and legacy programs, what we're doing is sort of setting up an anchor campaign and then taking people through the process of giving them feedback on what we originally asked for,
okay.
giving them updates on what we originally asked for.
There you go.
And so it takes a little bit of planning, because what you've got to do is you've got to say to yourself, particularly if you're dealing with research, which is slow moving, you know, what are we going to talk about, and what angles and what different signatures and what different engagement factors are we going to undertake as we go across the year? So one of the things that we really want to do is we want to serve up different solutions to donors' needs. And so we spend a lot of time as charities on combating helplessness and, you know, creating opportunities to give around our mission. But we sometimes forget that donors also need to be included. They need social status, and they want to be entertained. And when we have very serious subjects that we raise money for, sometimes the word entertainment scares people.
Mm.
But remember, what I give to you, we want people to see something in their mailbox or get an email from you, and we want them to say, oh my gosh, I can't wait to open that. It's more than just becoming relevant in an individual's life. It's also about engaging them as a part of the sort of the inside track, if you will.
Yeah.
So that's why content is so, so important around the communications.
Do you have an example of something that might be about a serious topic but still entertain or be at
yeah.
least engaging enough that somebody would be eager to open it?
Yeah. So we have a wonderful case study from Canada. Toronto General Western Hospital Foundation has been on a 2.5-year journey around mid-value and legacy development. And what we created was an designated, undesignated fund where donors could give to it. We had 4 of the top areas, including heart and brain and arthritis, that were in the program. And then what we've done over the last 2 years is built different components of that. The packages are enormous. They have multiple signatories. They have multiple sort of elements within the package. And then what we've done is we've built out different events, different stewardship and communications pieces on all of that, and brought it back and really brought it alive. And donors have responded unbelievably to it.
Mm.
So it's a completely different way of treating people. And the reason that we think it's so successful is because it's actually relevant for the donors that are giving at this, you know, thousand in their case, $1,000 to $25,000. When donors look at it, when they read it, and we do our focus group around that, donors really look at it and say, this is for me.
Mm.
And it's highly personalized, and it feels like we know them. And
yeah.
it's not just, we're not just saying, oh, you're special because, you know, you give more money to us. We're actually treating them as if they are special and that we understand their special role in our organizations.
Yeah.
So I think it changes the experience for the donor, which I think is key.
Yeah. How do small organizations get involved in something like this? How can
yeah.
they can make their mid-level donors
yep.
feel special?
I think small organizations have a strategic advantage over large ones in that they know their donors better.
Mm-hmm.
So when we have smaller donor files, and I've been in a small shop myself, you know, one of the advantages that we have is knowing people. And we have a client we work with that is amazing at tracking information around what donors talk about, what they understand, what they're engaged in, and what they love to communicate about, and actually building content around that. So when you have a smaller shop, you don't often have some of the budgets and some of the resources that others have, but what you do have is personalization and knowledge. And so trying to use that to your advantage. A lot of the programs that the very basis for them is mail, and then we layer on digital and both email and some of the elements on the website. We obviously include some, you know, donor events and a lot of stewardship elements and things like that. But at the core is mail. And I think small shops can do that. They just need to budget differently for those high value donors. Mm-hmm. They need to kind of budget into their plan for the year elements of additional touch points.
So what's the number one thing that organizations need to incorporate into their mid and high donor value programs?
Yeah, I think it's about listening to donors. And I think opportunities for two-way conversation. That's, you know, I think it's about opportunities that allow the organization to change what they're delivering to those donors in order to engage them more.
When you say listening to donors,
yeah,
that organizations should listen to their donors, yeah, what is that look like to an organization that has never done that? What type of questions should
right.
they be
right.
asking?
Right. Listening to our donors really means that we're providing opportunities for two-way dialogue. It's also looking at data a little bit differently. Sometimes donors tell us things that we don't always listen to. And when you have a donor that, for example, we pay a lot of attention to donors that call us with an address change, this actually means that a donor wants you to contact them.
Yes.
I mean, think about that. That's,
yeah,
isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
So people kind of look at that as an administrative action. But we don't look at it like that. When we're doing propensity modeling for mid-value and legacy, we look at those kinds of behaviors and say to ourselves, that's a donor who really wants to engage with us.
Yeah.
And so it's really looking at your program and paying a little more attention to some of the things that donors tell us that we kind of just think are just everyday occurrences, right?
Yeah, I think paying attention to people who call in with an address change is a great example. Do you have any others?
Yeah, we are always looking for outliers. And, you know, often in our big annual programs, we've got people who we ask for $100 from and they give us $200. Or we ask for $100 from and they give us $400. Looking at even those kinds of behaviors, that's the kind of things we build into our propensity models, because we think, isn't that fascinating? I asked you for 100, but you were inspired by whatever, you know, mission or proposition I was putting in front of you to do more. Why is that? And we start to kind of build a collective knowledge in targeting those people of saying, well, you know, maybe Amy is really excited about this program, about what we're doing. Mm. And so data can be very powerful. And I think even small organizations can use their own information to their advantage. And then we actually have to pay attention to what the research has told us, Amy, and we have to say to ourselves, what do donors need to do more with my organization? Maybe they don't want 12 different asks across the year. Maybe they want, you know, to be taken on a journey and they want content that is actually interesting and authentic. And I've got lots of examples of what that looks like, but on a whole, I'll say that it is information and sort of packages that people really want to open and they get excited. And that's why we're seeing revenues, you know, double in our mid-value program if we're doing things right. And we're seeing people go to legacy in droves, basically, because we think when you treat people right, they actually do more with our organizations.
That's great. Final thoughts, yep, and key takeaways for our viewers?
Well, you know, mid-value and legacy donors are absolutely my personal favorite donors in the whole world. And I think we just need to do more. I think we need to do some of the heavy lifting. We can't just throw everything at our donors and expect them to sort us out. We actually have to do the prioritization and the planning. And I think if we do that well, and we do it with all of our cohorts in our organization, so yes, finance, major gift, you know, people in the annual, I think people need to come together and actually think about what it feels like to have a donor to our organization. And if they do that well, I think donors engage and I think donors give more.
That's great. Thank you so much for joining
Thanks
us.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks so much for joining me. For even more videos, interviews, tools, and resources, I hope you'll visit my website, amyeisenstein.com, and subscribe to my weekly newsletter.